Good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to call this meeting to order and begin by acknowledging that we're meeting today and gathered here today on Treaty 6 territory, a traditional gathering place both in the past and in the present for many First Nations, Métis, and Inuit peoples. I acknowledge the many contributions that First Nations, Métis, and Inuit people have given and will continue to give to this place that we call home. I also want to mention just briefly that as trustees, we recently met as a group to talk about Treaty 6 and reflect on what Treaty 6 means to us. It was truly an important conversation, and I think important in our own journeys towards truth and reconciliation, and my own journey and realization that we are all treaty people. I'd like to advise everyone that the fire alarm system at the Center for Education is a two-alarm system. Stage one is a single repeating alarm tone indicating a warning only and evacuation is not required. Stage two is a triple repeating alarm tone indicating that evacuation is required. For those attending this meeting in person, please be advised the floor area is restricted to the people currently sitting here as well as media. I will signify to any other staff or registered speakers to come down at the designated time on the agenda. Thanks for your cooperation. I'll now ask everyone to stand for the singing of O Canada. I'd like to call on the superintendent for roll call.
Chair, Trustee Draper is absent. All of the trustees are present.
Thank you, superintendent. Now I'll call on Trustee Adams to move that the agenda be approved as printed.
So move, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Trustee Adams. Are there any questions or comments on the agenda? Trustee Johnner.
Thank you, Madam Chair. It's not so much on the agenda, but on behalf of your colleagues, I would like to welcome you to the very first public board meeting where you are at the helm chairing. So a big, happy welcome and happy to have you there.
Thank you, Trustee Johnner. As you said that, my screen went crazy here. Okay, so with that in mind, I ask and I indulge your patience as this my first meeting as board chair, but thank you for that, those kind remarks and that kind introduction. Back to the agenda. I'm going to call the vote now on approving the agenda as printed with a show of hands, please. And that is unanimously carried. Communications from the board chair, and again, I ask your patience. It's been a busy summer, and so I have a lengthy remarks from the board chair. I would like to begin by extending a huge and warm welcome and welcome back to the more than 105,000 students at Edmonton Public Schools, as well as their families and our staff. And of course, a huge welcome back to my colleagues on the Board of Trustees. It is an honor to serve alongside all of you. A new school year in my mind is a bit like a new calendar year. It's energizing in my mind to witness and be part of the energy in our schools at this time of year. I also want to thank the staff at Edmonton Public who've been working so hard these last couple of weeks to create and will continue to create safe, caring, and inclusive schools and classrooms across our district. As Trustee Johnner pointed out, this is my first public board meeting as board chair, and I would like to take a moment to thank former board chair Michelle Draper for her service, as well as former vice chair Bridget Sterling for her service as well. I'm honored to serve in this role alongside Vice Chair Sheila Dunn. So with this new school year, there are some additional challenges. In the spring, as you're well aware, our board passed a budget based on a number of assumptions. Not having a provincial budget means we begin this school year with a number of uncertainties. And it's safe to say that uncertainties create challenges, and many of our schools had to make tough decisions for this fall based on the assumptions that we made as a Board of Trustees. In some schools, this may mean there's more students in a class. It also may mean previous supports offered at school, for example, mental health therapists, may not be available. The board really looks forward to the tabling of the government's budget in October and continued strong investment in public education. Our students deserve it. We have critical infrastructure needs and require ongoing, predictable, adequate funding to support our growing student population. On nutrition funding, I'm pleased that the Minister of Education sees the value of funding this critically important program in our district and is maintaining funding for this coming school year. As we will talk about later in this meeting, the connection between nutrition and a student's ability to learn in our classrooms is critical. I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge that it has been a busy summer. For example, the quick introduction of the Education Act, as well as the new regulations. Thinking long term, we know that the Education Act could have implications for our families here at Edmonton Public. The full implication of the new act and the regulations are still being figured out, and part of fully understanding what it means hinges on what is in or what isn't in the provincial budget. And finally, on the McKinnon report, the board is concerned about any budget cuts to education and how that will affect our classrooms. Education, as I've mentioned already, but I think it's important to note here again, education needs predictable, long-term, sustainable funding for all students. I'd also like to clearly state that we cannot, as a board, support a funding model that is solely tied to student performance. We, as a district, are certainly open to finding new efficiencies and shared services between school boards, and in fact have been working with other districts collaboratively to find these efficiencies. That is my report. I'll now call on the superintendent if he has any communications. Superintendent.
Thanks, Madam Chair. We must have compared notes. I just want to start out by just thanking our staff that have worked over the summer. There's Edmonton Public is a busy place, even over the summer months. Our maintenance staff is working hard, custodial staff. And we also have a number of 12-month staff members that are developing resources, organizing professional development. It takes a lot to start the school year out, and including some offering summer institutes for professional development and some of our staff giving up a portion of their summer holidays to do some learning, to sharpen their own saws, to get ready to meet the needs of our children. I just want to say thanks to everyone. And over the last week, we opened the doors to our building, our 105,000 kids, and we welcomed them, and we're going to care for them, and we're going to do everything that we can to ensure that they're successful. And I want to thank everyone for their combined effort. Teaching is truly a team game. Board Chair, you mentioned some uncertainty. with respect to our budget. And I know this is weighing heavily on the minds of our staff, our parents, and our students across the district. There's lots of uncertainty in education, but what's going to keep us connected in Edmonton Public Schools is our shared values, our unwavering commitment to children, and keeping the main thing, and that's the success of our kids. So no matter what happens, I know that that's what our staff is focused on in our buildings, and it gives me great comfort to know that we're all rowing in the same direction to ensure that our kids are getting what they need to be successful, which is part of our cornerstone value of equity. And of course, you know, with any start of the new school year, as folks start to get settled in, there can be some bumps along the way. And the best place, if there are some issues that are emerging in our schools for our families, the best place to start the conversation is with their classroom teacher and their school principal. And if they need additional support from there, district support services, and we all are you know, working to help resolve whatever issues come to pass. It's truly an honor to get up every day in service of kids. And I know that we're going to be having lots of conversation in the coming months about education in this province. I'm very proud of what we have accomplished in Edmonton, in Alberta. We have a tremendous education system, and I think through all this conversation, we need to be grounded in that notion that we have a tremendously robust and effective public education system in the province of Alberta, one that serves Albertans very, very well, and serves our kids as they transition to post-secondary studies and the world of work. Our kids are ready for the future. And is there room for improvement? Always. We always strive to continuously improve. And that's one of the reasons why it's such an honor to serve this district and to serve this Board of Trustees, because we always are focused on how we can do things a little bit better. So with that, we're off to a great school year. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Superintendent, for your strong and inspiring words. Now on to the minutes. I'd like to call on Trustee Sterling to move that the minutes of the board meeting from June 25th be approved as printed. Stand by. Just watching for that light. So moved, Madam Chair. Thank you, Trustee Sterling. Are there any additions or corrections to the minutes? All those in favor with a show of hands, please. And the motion is unanimously carried. Now I'd like to call on Trustee Gibson to move that the minutes be approved as printed for the organizational board meeting held on June 25th.
So moved, Madam Chair.
Are there any corrections or additions to the minutes? Seeing none, all those, I'll call the vote by a show of hands, please. And the minutes are carried. We have no registered speakers from our public and staff group representatives at this time. Moving on to reports. Next on the agenda is actions taken under the delegation of authority during our summer recess. I'll ask if there's any trustee comments or questions with respect to the report. Seeing none, I'd like to thank the superintendent for his leadership over the summer. And I know we had a good break as trustees. Okay, now we're moving on to the strategic plan update, the school nutrition program. I'll call on Ms. Peterson to introduce this report for us.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Today, administration is pleased to bring forward a strategic plan report in support of Priority 3, Goal 2, with a focus on school nutrition programming. Research has demonstrated the importance of proper nutrition in respect to how children are able to positively and fully participate in school. both from an academic and social-emotional perspective. Unfortunately, in Edmonton, there are families for whom food security is an ongoing challenge. According to 2018 City of Edmonton census data, 1 in 8 Edmontonians live in poverty. 40,000 of these are children, many of whom attend an Edmonton public school. The issue of students coming to school hungry is not a new situation in district classrooms. Our teachers have always seen firsthand the challenges and signs that a child may be sitting in class too hungry to focus, too hungry to learn. Due to this close connection between teachers and their students, school staff have often provided an informal response to student hunger, such as keeping a box of granola bars on hand for students who need something to eat. Over 20 years ago, educators and key members of Edmonton's Food Security Network began to explore how to better leverage the role schools could play in ensuring children in socially vulnerable communities have access to nutrition programming. This resulted in Norwood School and E4C launching the first daily school lunch program in the district. Gradually, awareness and culture around school nutrition programming began to emerge. Today, many district schools, particularly those working in socially vulnerable communities, work with a range of community partners to provide some sort of nutrition support for their students and families. The 2018-2019 data from the District School Community Relationship Tracker Tool identified 77 schools working with over 61 community stakeholders to support school nutrition programming within their school community. These school nutrition partners are invaluable to the schools they support. However, this grassroots community approach to school nutrition is not a predictable, systemic response to addressing childhood hunger in Alberta. In 2016, Alberta Education launched a pilot to begin to address this critical gap. The provincial school nutrition program is currently in 22 district schools serving some of our most socially vulnerable communities. The program enables these schools to provide a daily morning meal made up of 4 food groups for students who choose to access this support. The Alberta Education School Nutrition Program provided adequate funding that enabled the 22 participating schools to address the equipment necessary to support proper food handling safety standards, the infrastructure required to support the volume of food needed to feed an entire school community, the funding needed to cover the actual cost of a daily morning meal, and the funding to support designated staffing required to plan, prepare, and serve a daily morning meal. Yesterday's announcement from Alberta Education that the school nutrition program funding would be maintained for this school year was important news for the district's 22 schools and the families they serve. Schools have become a logical and critical partner in the community's efforts to address food security and ensure that every child has a predictable and daily access to healthy food. At this time, administration is happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you, Ms. Peterson. I now welcome my colleagues with questions or comments on this report. Trustee Sterling.
There you go. Thank you. I've been really impressed with the provincial program and the way that it's allowed us to have daily nutrition supports provided for our students, and I think that's really important for children in nutrition programs. But I'm mindful, at least to my awareness, that at least some of our schools who are providing some snack programs or things like that are not necessarily able to provide those every day. Do we have a context within our 77 schools, how many are providing lunch versus snack programs versus other options, breakfast, and how many of those schools are able to do it daily as compared to maybe only once or twice a week?
Ms. Peterson?
Thank you for the question, Madam Chair. We don't have a specific chart that would show us specifically every program in every school. We know that the continuum is very broad. We have schools that are able to offer snack and lunch 5 days a week, and we have other schools that work with a range of community supports, and they might be able to offer something 2 or 3 times a week. We have some schools that are able to offer something daily, but it might be to 25 students.
Trustee Sterling, do you have a follow-up question?
No, not a question specifically. I did want to say that certainly I'm aware of a number of schools in the Central Southeastern Ward G that are even only able to provide once a week thanks to some community generosity, and that's a concern to me, because if there's a need once a week, it's certainly probably a need more than once a week for a lot of kids.
Ms. Peterson?
Thank you for the question, or maybe it's a comment. I would concur that many of our principals are working really hard with community supports, and that, as indicated in the report, our grassroots efforts are not always able to fully meet the need that would be appropriate.
Trustee Adams.
Chair. I really was happy to see how many, you know, more schools have been added. We've added 20 more schools, and you started out with 2 in this pilot, so that's a lot that's been added. My question is, I'm wondering, do we know how many more schools would actually require daily, the daily serving of food in their schools?
Ms. Peterson.
Thank you for the question. The 22 schools that we have here were identified using multiple sources of information. We looked at the high social vulnerability list. We talked to school principals and asked them to engage in a conversation within their school community and get a sense of what the need was. And we also looked at where there were existing supports. So if we were to look at the opportunity to expand the program, we would want to engage with schools and have principals be talking with their students, their staff, and their families to accurately identify how many schools would wish to have the security and the predictability of a daily program.
Trustee Adams, do you have another question?
Just to kind of follow up, do we feel like we have identified the most needy schools? Do we feel like we really are fulfilling that? I know there's going to be much more need, but are these the schools that we're satisfied with, that these are the most needy schools that we need to provide for?
Ms. Peterson.
Chair, the schools that are currently part of the program were identified using our district's high social vulnerability list, using conversations with principals, and looking at where we have other supports in place. And so we filled the gap in what we believe to be our most needy or most complex schools.
Superintendent.
Thanks very much, Madam Chair. I just would want to point out in Appendix 1 of the report, there's a listing, a comprehensive list of our community partners who've agreed that we can publish, you know, names using our school community tracker tool. And so in terms of identification of the neediest schools and, you know, does someone need, you know, programming 1 day a week, 2 days a week, There's clearly a need in a whole bunch of our schools for nutrition support. And even with the dollars that we're getting from the province, we are not fully meeting that need. So I just wanted to acknowledge the work of our community partners. And as we go forward, there needs to be a recognition that that funding from the province isn't the whole picture. It's only part of the picture. And so there could be some schools that are getting some supports through our community partners that are actually in an equally or maybe even a increased vulnerable position in terms of their community and a need, kids living in poverty. So we have taken those resources and we've applied them into the places that we felt that, you know, there were some gaps. But we certainly do highly value also the work of our grassroots partners that have been with us for many, many years. So I just wanted to point that out in the conversation.
Thank you, Superintendent. Trustee Dunn.
Thank you. My question is around the district dollars that were invested to support facility upgrades. So I'm just kind of curious if we know the amount of money we've invested in that, and then what types of upgrades have been provided to support the school nutrition.
Ms. Peterson? Thank you for the question. The work was done to upgrade things like electrical and water lines to support the type of equipment that you use when you're feeding 150 or 250 people a day. So the size of fridges and the proper kinds of sanitizing dishwashers, those kinds of things. And when we received the allocation to expand to the 22 schools, the superintendent approved up to a maximum of $300,000 to support those facility infrastructure upgrades. And then the money from the province was used to buy the actual dishwashers, refrigerators, et cetera.
Superintendent?
So in terms of a breakdown of where that work happened and whatnot, if you would like, we can provide that certainly. We have to observe food handling regulations and safety code and all that sort of thing. So this work was necessary and for us to introduce snack programs and nutrition programs in some of those schools. So thank you.
Thank you. Trustee Jans. Oh, you took it off. Thank you, Trustee Jans. Trustee Ip.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just a question about background and some context. So my understanding is that prior to the school nutrition program, E4C has been a longtime partner in delivering the hot lunch program, I believe. And so what are the key differences between the school nutrition program and the hot lunch program that did exist, or perhaps it's still being run by E4C, but from some other programs that that were in our schools previously.
Thank you, Trustee Ms. Peterson.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Yes, E4C has had a longstanding relationship with our district as well as Edmonton Catholic Schools and has provided a hot lunch program in our city, primarily in highly social vulnerable schools located in the city center. Prior to the 2016 funding coming in, the hot lunch program would have been a hot meal that came from an institutional caterer and delivered to each of the schools in the program. The school nutrition program dollars enabled us to work with E4C and explore a different delivery model and a different way of looking at school nutrition. And so the fresh foods approach was implemented in Norwood School in the first year of the school nutrition program, where we looked at having fresh fruit on hand and having children have a lot more choice, a lot more advocacy, families being able to be involved in contributing food from home. And also the food extends past that particular meal. It's like having a big refrigerator. So the food would be served on a given day and children would have vegetables, sandwiches, yogurt, and milk. And what wasn't eaten could be properly stored and used again as part of a morning snack the next day or as part of lunch later in the week. This model, like I said, empowers kids to have more choice. It is more efficient, there's not as much wastage, and the fresh foods approach had more fruits and vegetables coming into the nutritional value of the meal that was provided to students, and parents had a much more active role. A family could easily send their child with some leftover rice and know that their child would have protein and fruits and vegetables from the nutrition program.
Trustee Epp, do you have a second question? I again would just like to echo my colleagues and thank you for this report. One of the things that stands out for me is just again how invaluable the partnerships that we have, and I think how grateful certainly I am as a trustee who has a number of schools in my ward that I know have school nutrition programs. My question is around, so we get all these donations from our partner organizations. How do we as a district ensure that those donations are distributed equitably?
Thank you for the question. So on my little team, we're working with many of the schools that have school nutrition programs. We work very deliberately with the 22 schools in the cohort, but we're also involved in helping many of the other schools access the different grants and the different partnerships. So we serve as a common conduit to many of the donations, and we're in constant communication with schools around different opportunities that come up. So if we become aware of a donation right now, as an example, we have applesauce and eggs and cereal that we're currently navigating from a donor out to schools that would be able to leverage good use of those donations. So we can connect with principals, we see what they have, what they need, and we make the best match possible to be able to best capitalize on those donations.
Thank you. Trustee Jantz.
Thank you. I wanted to ask the administration, to me, when I read this report, it was simply excellent and very powerful. And it aligns with all the feedback I've heard in the community from students, staff, and families about how wonderful this is. I'm wondering about the opportunity to scale this up or do more. What sort of a provincial funding investment or partner investment or how would we be able to scale this up and expand it further?
Ms. Peterson.
Thank you for the question. Obviously, scaling would involve additional funds. The dollars that we currently receive in our designated budget line supports the 22 schools, and we will work with E4C in the delivery of our pilot this year to look at the budget and see if there would be room to expand. There is a caution around expansion, though, and that is the long-term predictability of the funding as well. This spring and fall, as we prepared for this school year and up until yesterday, had some uncertainty around the funding to support the program. We were then working with each of the schools on looking at how to recreate or find an alternate source of funding so that the program could continue. So predictable funding would be key to expanding significantly to more schools in the district so that we could ensure that we could build a culture, we could build capacity, we could ensure that school kitchen and food preparation areas meet standards, and that over the long term schools would have access to the funding required to support the resourcing of the actual program.
Do you have a follow-up question, Trustee Jantz?
I do, and thank you for that, and certainly long-term sustainability is duly noted. I was reading this summer, according to End Poverty Edmonton, the poverty profile for Edmonton in 2019, 1 in 10, or approximately 120,000 Edmontonians are experiencing poverty, including 9,705, so almost 10,000 lone parent families. So there's 10,000 lone parent families. Through our work, we're roughly feeding 4,700 kids. There's probably room to double this program to feed the needy kiddos in our city. So I think we need to think about this as a board with some of our other community partners and how we can bring more people to breakfast. So thank you very much for all the hard work, and please convey it to our partners. The board is very grateful.
Thank you, Trustee Jantz. Well said. Are there any other comments or questions from my colleagues? Sure. Let's absolutely go with the second round. Trustee Adams.
Yeah, thank you very much. I know that just doing one of these in one school is a lot of work. And I didn't think that teachers were a part of that. It seems like they were either gathering volunteers or they were hiring people to come in and work with this, because I mean, it's a huge program to provide that much food for, you know, doing it properly and following all the health regulations. So I'm wondering, does this take away from any of our teachers? Like, are they still, I mean, if they wanted to be involved, I'm sure they could be, but are they free when they have this program in their school to be able to continue with their own work? I guess, do you understand what I'm saying? Yeah.
I see the superintendent. I'll go to superintendent and then yourself, Ms. Peterson.
Thanks very much for the question. Certainly our teachers volunteer their time, you know, as appropriate to meet the needs of the children under their care. Our support staff have important roles to play, you know, with respect to working with kids and families. And we have volunteers that help support these programs. And so each program is a little bit unique in terms of their approach to put the food on the table, so to speak, but everyone is pitching in. And we're very grateful, for the commitment of our volunteers and our staff to help with this program.
Ms. Peterson, would you like to add anything to that?
Just one comment. When we were able to go into the 20 new schools, one of the pieces that came back in feedback was having a predictable, systemic approach to the program did gain back instructional time for many of the teachers. So the expertise of working with our partner and having something in place, having the right food handling equipment and all of those things, enabled our staff who are educators to spend more time focused on their mandate and still have a very rigorous nutrition program for the students.
That's a valuable piece of information. Trustee Adams, do you have another question?
The other thing that I noticed in the report is that you're adding, or it has been added, the educational aspect to this in order to keep, well, to help the students and the families to be able to make good choices in their life long term. And I think that's a very important part of this education, so that they're getting, we're not just feeding them, but we're actually teaching them how to make good choices when they eat and the food that they choose. Report really did give us a lot of good information on that, so I just wanted to, I know I didn't ask a question, I'm sorry.
That's quite fine, Trustee Adams. Questions and comments. Trustee Sterling.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So I wanted to sort of go to the question of universality. So we know that we are the, I believe at this point in time, Canada is the only G7 country without a national school nutrition approach. In part because of the division of powers in Canada and where education sits, but also because we don't have a national school nutrition strategy. I first of all wanted to say that I think, that the school nutrition should be a universally available program to students in all schools. I know that's not a question you want to answer, but I'm going to say right out there that this is certainly the research evidence would show that school nutrition, universally available school nutrition, is one of the best ways to help every child have a better chance of success in school, right? That we know it's one of the simplest and easiest ways to improve educational outcomes is to ensure students have adequate and appropriate nutrition every day. But I wanted to ask, because I think this is a question that you might be able to answer, is in our schools where the school nutrition program is functioning, it's a program that's available to every child in the school. We don't means test it. We don't designate it based on, which kids do we think are the hungry kids and which kids aren't. Whereas I know in some other schools, we only provide it to a small number of students that might be perceived as high needs. And I wonder if you could speak a bit to the social impact that has for students when everybody gets to participate and nobody is singled out in terms of participating in the program. Because I think that's something I've seen when I visited the schools, but I'm wondering if you could speak a bit more to how we're seeing that affect the school culture and the feelings of students around being fed at school.
Ms. Peterson.
Thank you, Madam Chair. In the school nutrition program in the 22 schools, the program is available to every student every day. And children and families make decisions about whether they want to access that program. And then because of the large numbers of children who potentially are participating each day, it's typically held in larger spaces. And it does create that social environment around food. And so in many of the schools, children come in with their parents and they gather every morning for breakfast. And it's a great way to start the day. Sit down and eat a meal together. And many of the feedbacks, the feedback that we did with schools, they noted the impact that the program had on the social, emotional well-being of the students. They were calmer, they were more focused, but they also were getting to know each other better, and they were connecting the way that people do when you sit and eat a meal together. So there is that element of the socialization in a school community and how food can help build relationships as well.
Trustee Sterling, do you have another question?
The other piece I wanted to ask about, I know this is a piece that is included in the school nutrition program as well, is the educational component around eating food, learning how to eat, learning how to understand your body and hunger and all of those things. So I'm wondering if you could speak a bit to how the program is actually not just a way we feed kids, but also a way we teach.
Ms. Peterson.
Thank you for the question, Madam Chair. In looking at the fresh food approach, one of the things that was philosophically really important working with the school staff and working with E4C was to ensure that children were active participants in the program and that they understood what it meant to feel hungry and they understood the importance of nutrition and different food groups and balanced meals. And so part of what happens when the kids are in the program is adults are asking them questions of, you know, How do you feel hungry today? What have you already eaten today? What do you think you might like to eat based on what you already have eaten? Students are taught about label reading and the importance of looking at things like sugars and sodium and looking for things like protein on labels. So when they're not necessarily eating the food from the program, but they might have some food from home, like a juice box or something, they can understand the nutrition of that food as well. Additionally, as Trustee Adams had indicated, there was work done this summer on lesson plans, and so teachers from the school nutrition program came in and did some summer work, and they developed some complementary lesson plans to be used in Division I and Division II with their students that build off of having the program in their school, and again, a way of having kids reflect on their own nutrition and understanding nutrition to help them as they grow up to be young adults and navigate grocery stores and making healthy choices for themselves.
Thank you for that, Ms. Peterson. Trustee Dunn.
Thank you. Just a comment from me. I can't think of more important work, so I wanted to thank you for really shining a light on the work that's being done in our schools and how that funding is really improving the lives of students in our district. So I'm seeing in this report that a food program increases learning, it is beneficial for attendance and behavior, and I think for those reasons alone it's worth having a universal system. I'm in agreement with my colleague. In my opinion, having food available when you're hungry is also an issue of well-being. So I was encouraged when I saw the Education Act come out and include the word well-being for the first time in education legislation. So that was a positive step for me. And I think it reminds me of a theory in psychology called the hierarchy of needs, which is basically the idea that before you can have well-being, you need to have your physiological needs met. So hunger, clothing, and then your safety needs met, and then you can start talking about well-being. And so when I hear nutrition program, I'm thinking that's just the secure foundation we need to start working on that. So when we as a province, and I consider everyone in this room part of that because we vote for our provincial government, when we expand the scope of school boards to focus on well-being, I also think we need to expand the board's ability to provide for well-being. So I'm so happy that the school nutrition program is continued to be funded for the next year. I'd love to see this program expand. Because schools can be a secure foundation for children, but we need predictable funding for that to become a secure foundation. So we don't want to be up in the air about, is this going to happen this year so we can provide this for our kids? So thanks for the report.
Thank you, Trustee Dunn, for that. Trustee Gibson.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I was intrigued by Trustee Jones's inquiry as to how to grow the program, and a couple of questions, thoughts, and perhaps this is a role for the Health and Well-being Committee to consider, but have, you know, the model that we have right now with the foundation was adding additional schools one by one for full-day kindergarten. Has there been any dialogue with the foundation about possibility of expanding their role into this area? That'd be my first question.
Superintendent.
Thanks very much, Madam Chair. I believe later this fall, perhaps even into December. I'm not entirely sure of the date, Trustee Gibson. We have a conversation scheduled with the board to talk about the foundation and potentially an expanded mandate, and that could certainly be part of it.
Go ahead, Trustee Gibson.
So I suspect that for many of the folks who read this report, the list of partners that are identified would be new information. And there's literally tens of thousands of organizations in this city that could be potential donors, and I expect only a tiny fraction would even be aware of this program and that their peer organizations are in fact contributing. So I wonder, one of the questions I have is, have we considered the recruitment of a media sponsor, for example, the Edmonton Journal, to help the recognition of the benefit to students and the role of community partners? Because I believe that while it's true that we've got to be careful about not creating unsustainable circumstances, if the pool of potential donors was amplified by several factors, in essence, that is one way to safeguard against sustainability being interrupted. So I just wonder, where is the right home for this for our board to do a bit more strategizing if we see that this is an important priority that we'd like to continue? Question for the admin necessarily to answer, but I'll leave it with my board colleagues. Mm.
A few questions in there, a few thoughts. Superintendent, Ms. Peterson, either of you like to respond?
Well, thanks very much, and some very intriguing ideas. I think that the more that people are aware of the need out there and what some of our community partners are stepping up to do, I think it just, that in itself just speaks to more people getting involved to try to, solve a very complex problem. I wonder if there's also a significant role for End Poverty Edmonton in this whole dialogue and bringing our community partners together, for a robust conversation about, sustainability around nutrition programming. But I think that shining a light through media sponsors is an excellent idea, and look forward to having a conversation with the board about, how we can make that happen.
Thank you for that, and huge thanks to my colleagues for your thoughtful and insightful questions. And again, thanks to administration and staff for a thorough report on this important program. I'll now call on Vice Chair Dunn to introduce the bereavement report.
It is with regret that I report on the following bereavements. Mr. Talvinder Jasser passed away on July 3rd, 2019 at the age of 55 years. Mr. Jasser was hired to the district in January 1990 and spent his 19-year career working as head custodian at Parkview, Pollard Meadows, Winelows, Avalon, Kahewin, and Rideau Park schools. He is survived by his wife, Gardish, his children, Vishal and Jatin, as well as numerous family and friends. Mr. Jasser was on leave of absence prior to his passing. A memorial service celebrating Mr. Tavinder's life was held on July 3rd, 2019. Mr. Dave Kowalczyk passed away on July 29th, 2019 at the age of 53 years. Mr. Kowalczyk was hired to the district in August 1989. He spent his 30-year career working as a teacher at Homesteader, Bissett, and Kirkness schools, assistant principal at Dunluce School and principal at Athlone, Forest Heights, and Carnarvon schools. He is survived by his wife, Mary Muir, daughter Claire, son Quinn, his father John, siblings Mark and Darlene, as well as a large extended family that was dear to his heart. A memorial service celebrating Dave's life was held on August 10th, 2019. Mrs. Anna Letellier passed away on June 27th, 2019 at the age of 62 years. Mrs. Letellier was hired to the district in September 1991 and spent her 27-year career as a custodial assistant at Richard C. Court, Edith Rogers, Malmo, Millwoods, Ritchie, J. Percy Page, Jasper Place, Crawford, Harry Ainley, and Sven Hansen schools. Mrs. Letellier was on a leave of absence prior to her passing. A memorial service celebrating Anna's life was held on July 12, 2019. Mrs. Kathy Peterson passed away on August 10, 2019, at the age of 55 years. Mrs. Peterson was hired to the district in August 1989 and spent her 30-year career as a teacher at Brandner Garden, Ellerslie, Westbrook, Center High, and W.P. Wagner schools. Mrs. Peterson was on leave prior to her passing. She is survived by her husband Norm, brother Todd, close family, and her fur kids, Sydney and Hudson. A memorial service celebrating Kathy's life was held on August 15, 2019. Mrs. Martina Plum passed away on May 24, 2019, at the age of 57 years. Mrs. Plum was hired to the district in September 1983 and spent her 26-year career working as a teacher at Forest Heights School. She survived by her husband Miles, her children Caitlin, Paul, and Danica, her parents, siblings, and numerous family and friends. Mr. Christopher Apostle passed away on July 16, 2019, at the age of 46 years. Mr. Apostle was hired to the district in February 1999 and spent his 20-year career as a teacher at Victoria and Jasper Place schools. He survived by his father Art, stepmother Janet, his sisters, stepsisters, and brothers, nieces, nephews, and numerous family and friends. A memorial service celebrating Chris's life was held on July 22, 2019. Mr. Jeffrey Wade Sim passed away on August 13, 2019 at the age of 57 years. Mr. Sim was hired to the district in February 1982 and spent his 37-year career working as a maintenance worker, custodial assistant, head custodian, and custodial consultant. He's survived by his wife Bonnie, four children, two grandchildren, as well as many other family members. Mr. Sim was on a leave of absence prior to his passing. A memorial service celebrating Wade's life was held on August 24th, 2019.
Thank you, Trustee Dunn. Are there any committee, board representative, or trustee reports? Trustee Yip.
Thank you. On Saturday, September 7th, I had the pleasure of attending the first of a series of playground openings in the Southwest. This one was at Dr. Margaret Ann Arbor School, and several hundred parents and community members joined in the festivities along with other elected officials, including Member of Parliament Matt Genereux, Minister Casey Madu, and Councillor Cartmel. I want in particular to congratulate the Playground Committee for their hard work, and in particular Ms. Sherry McDonald as chair of the Playground Committee for allowing it to open on time. So congratulations to them. On September 7th and 8th, I attended a number of events within the Chinese community, in particular the Mid-Autumn Festival, attended the opening on Sunday along with other elected officials, and also attended in that evening the Fukanese Fukanese Association awards, and that community raised over $5,000 in scholarships to Edmonton public students, many of whom are actually students in our Mandarin bilingual program. So congratulations to the Fukanese Association, and thank you for their, I want to recognize and thank them for their support. And also finally to thank the many schools for welcoming me on the first day of school this year.
Thank you, Trustee Yip. Trustee Adams.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I was really pleased to have the opportunity to talk to some of the parents from the Satu School. The kindergarten and grade ones, you know, those ones are coming from Michael Strombisky, and they are really doing well. They love the school. There are some complications sometimes with busing, but it was really nice to talk to a number of them, and they're happy with the school. And their kids are doing well. So that was very satisfying to hear, knowing that there could have been, you know, difficulties and complications in that. And they of course, are looking forward to getting back to be in the school in Strumbiski, but still, the transition and that, the good work was done in that school. And I just want to thank the principal and the teachers, because the teachers are doing an excellent job welcoming them. And, you know, what could be a very difficult situation is it's really turned out well. So just want to say thank you to all those who have worked very hard to make that happen. Also, Dan Knott, I was there for their introduction, and they did an extremely great job in welcoming their kids back with all kinds of videos and that. They did about 3 or 4, and they have a new success coach, and it just seems like it's just going to be a real exciting year for them. So although those are the only two I got to, it was really very successful. And I do also want to thank the Millwoods President's Council. They meet every month, and this last month, last Thursday night, that's the presence of all the community leagues, and they gather together, Millwoods and South, that whole area. And they're very interested in being more involved with partnering in ways that maybe they could provide some kind of support. And I think that's significant for us, because they're very involved in their communities, and they can help us with communication. The other thing is they would like to be more aware of some of the district opportunities to be involved in as well, when we have meetings, community meetings, public meetings. So I know we have some work there to do, but I'm happy that we have some real potential. And I'm not sure how that partnership and what it would look like, but I think it's something that's good to look at, and thankful for their desire. So.
Thank you, Trustee Adams. Moving on now to trustee and board requests for information. Oh, pardon me. Go ahead, Trustee Jantz.
I just wanted to say, while the summer is a very busy time for all of us, I just wanted to give a shout out to our new chair, who has been, we shifted the calendar, so the chair picks up in June, and Chair Estabrooks has hit the ground running. And especially, I just wanted to say, I've heard a lot from a lot of concern from members of my community and parents and student staff and families around the whole issue of what's in a name, the public issue, the public and public education. And our chair has been very measured, firm, and sensible in terms of defending the interests of public education in our district, and for communicating clearly to our public about our needs, the uncertainty that we exist in right now with an uncertain provincial budget. And it's been a very fly-by-the-seat-of-our-pants kind of summer. While we appreciate having the school nutrition information now, it just seemed like at 11:59, right before our board meeting, we heard about this. So I wanted to commend our chair and of course all of us all of us who are supporting the chair in helping make sure that as wild as things are, that she is firmly on top of that bull. And I'm mixing metaphors. Here we go. Okay, thank you, Trish. Thank you, Chair Espres.
Thank you, Trustee Jans. Measured, firm, and sensible. I can live with that. Moving on, are there any trustee and board requests for information? Trustee Jans.
Thank you. This also came to me from a constituent. Are there, and I have the RFI in writing, are there implications for public education with regard to the new Fight Back Strategy Alberta inquiry into our classroom teaching and learning? What protections are available for students or staff who wish to form or participate in student clubs or fundraise? How can we continue to educate students about the impending climate emergency while safeguarding freedom of speech and inquiry for our students, staff, and families?
Thank you, Trustee Jans. Trustee Dunn.
Thank you. I've submitted to the secretary a list of questions for a request for information around seclusion and time out rooms. Does the district distinguish between seclusion rooms and timeout rooms? Why are seclusion rooms and or dedicated timeout rooms needed in our schools? What does the research say about the effectiveness of seclusion rooms at keeping students and staff safe compared to other strategies? How many seclusion rooms exist in the district? How does this compare to the number of seclusion rooms in the three other metro districts? How many times would a seclusion room or timeout room be used in a year? What are the requirements for parental notification and consent in the use of seclusion rooms and or dedicated timeout rooms? What training and professional development do staff receive in the use of seclusion rooms, physical restraint, and the practice of timeouts? How is the district working to prevent the use of seclusion rooms and or dedicated timeout rooms? And what are the other alternatives to using these rooms? And lastly, what are the steps to decommission these rooms?
Thank you, Trustee Dunn. Are there any other trustee or board requests for information? Moving on, are there any notices of motion?
Trustee Dunn. Thank you. I submitted a request for information about seclusion and timeout rooms. I'd also like to put forward a motion in two parts. The first is that Edmonton Public School Board advocate to the Minister of Education that involuntary confinement, seclusion rooms, or timeout rooms are not used as a punishment or behavior management technique and is only used as a last resort in emergency situations endangering the physical safety of students or staff. The second is that Edmonton Public School Board advocate to the Minister of Education for the systemic changes needed to work towards a system where these rooms are no longer needed or used through increased cross-ministry collaboration to serve students with disabilities and mental health concerns, increased inadequate funding for students in need of specialized supports, and increased funding for staff training and positive behavior supports, as well as increased funding for regulated specialists to work with teachers and educational assistants. Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Dunn. Are there any other notices of motion? Seeing none, I'll call on the superintendent to provide us with the next public board meeting date.
Thanks, Madam Chair. Next public board meeting is Tuesday, September 24th at 2 p.m.
Thank you, Superintendent, and thank you all for your patience on this, my first public board meeting. I declare this meeting adjourned.